Welcome, everybody. We are in the session one of our online class, software quality assurance class. And first three sessions are a trial, means we want you to get an idea of that class being something you like. We do not want your emotional kind of decisions versus logical, so we want you to be logical. We want you to say, okay, I do want it. I do have resources, means time. I am committed 100% to that, not 99, 100, because if there is just 99, guys, there's going to be 1% which will kick, you know, inside, and we're going to fail on that. So 100% commitment, hard work. So that is what we want you to evaluate while we go through three trial sessions. No pressure, no manipulation, no, I mean, really nothing like that. We want you to come and say, we do want it. Okay, that is my goal. I definitely want all of you to join, which never happened. But if you join, I want you to do that consciously. Honestly, it is an honor to talk to such a big group of people. We have 241 person in the class at the moment. And last time I talked to such a big group was definitely before the pandemic. And what can I say? So guys, welcome. And if you have a question, you can ask that question in Skype. I go to Skype all the time and to see if you have questions. So let me show you the groups we have. In each and every class, we have two chats. One chat is for communication while we are in the class, and that is the one you see it here. So May 18th trial. We do not write anything there in between sessions. Then we have informal chat where you communicate in between sessions. There is a very important rule to understand. Both chats are property of the school, okay? I am bringing people there. It is not a social network where you can go and, you know, take other people time, you know, distract them from, you know, whatever they are doing. Two chats, you communicate on subjects related to the class. Okay. Then another one to understand. We do not want you to bring any third party resources to the class. Okay. So you cannot come and say, you know what, there is a good book on C programming, and that is the book. You do not do that. So no resources, no recommendations, okay, without my approval. So nobody came here to study from you, okay? Just very simple. So everybody comes here to learn from me, and we do not want anybody to be distracted with unrelated things, okay? So that is how it works. I think we have probably 250 people in the class. We might go to the class page. Let me show you. Here is the class page. That is the URL. Onlineportnode.net, online home. You are supposed to know that URL because you were supposed to do the homework. So that is where we keep certain things for the first three trial sessions. So that is the summary, but then we have session one, session two, session three, and here you will see the recording for the previous session, class session one, and previous before previous session one, and so on. So you were supposed to go through the homework, and homework, for those who don't know yet, homework is done in a very specific way. So first of all, you go to homework assignment here for session one, and you watch the video. Then you study the questions and answers, basically interview type questions and answers. But we learn the subject that way. So if we open that page, okay, that is the one. That is the page with questions and answers. So that is, if you follow that link, you get there. And you learn the questions in order to be able to take the survey here, to take that survey and to provide answers out of what you study, not what you find on Google, not what you think personally, not what your friend told you, okay? So you study what we gave you here in the previous link, and then you answer the survey without copy-pasting from that page or any other resource. You are copy-pasting from your own mind, okay? That is the purpose. And then James Beck video is a kind of life-changing stuff. I mean, it tells you exactly what software testing is about, and that is the best piece I know about that. So I recommend watching that video. By the way, guys, I go back to your Skype group. Did you watch that video? Did you like it? Or let's say those who did watch the video, did you like it? Yes, okay. At least one person. Okay, two, four. Okay, now we have a lot. Okay, good. Now, guys, I told you we have two chats for the class. I didn't tell you we have that extra 2019. That one is for people who want to get invitations to your sessions. So most of them never come. You see 550 people here. I don't think we might expect more than 20, 30 to come, but they want to stay in that group anyway. So that is for people who graduated recently or 3 years ago and 5 years ago, whatever. So if you want to repeat the classes, okay, you tell me, Michael, I want to be in the chat. And so they receive all the invitations. You can see it here. That is the invitation I sent to you and I sent it to them. So you understand why I move in between a couple of chats. So I do not go to informal chat here. So you are not supposed to communicate there while we are in the class. So we are all here in the trial, okay? Okay, keep going. So that is your homework. Here is the list of questions which you are supposed to be able to answer when it comes to, let's say, interview or let's say you talk to someone. Definitely our goal is to get a job, so we want to be doing well when it comes to an interview. And since you answered, at least many of you answered the quiz, so we will go there. Let me refresh the screen. And it says that, how many? 139 of you took the test. And what we're going to do now, we will look at what you've done, and I will comment on what is happening here. Also, each and every session, I have a notepad file that is yours, okay? Notepad file, session one, May 18th, where I take notes, and that file will go to the chat later on. I am reusing some, you know, older files, you know, sometimes, but again, I am modifying them. Even if I reuse them, I am modifying them to update for your specific class. So what makes software career, QA career, attractive to you? Has nothing to do with knowledge of software testing, but that is kind of positioning question of that. Who are you? Why are you here? So What makes you better than other candidates in terms of your motivation? And then we have what? Most of you, 77%, are saying, I enjoy working in IT / high-tech environment, which is good. So I just like it. You do not need any reason for why you like this or that, why you like strawberry ice cream, not blueberry ice cream. You just like it. It allows me to make more money. Guys, money is important. I mean, I'm not the one who will tell you it's not important. It is not something we bring to the conversation. Same as you talk to a doctor and you say, doctor, are you in your doctor business because it pays more money? They will be offended, guys. They say, what do you mean? I mean, I like to help people. It comes with certain money, but they like to help people. At least some of them do. So we do not bring money to the interview. Create jobs are safer than my job in current profession. Guys, I don't know if you work maybe in a dynamite factory, but really, jobs are not safe more than other professions. What gives you the safety is your skill level. So the more you know, the more you are protected, you know, from different things which might happen to your employment. So it is basically in your hands. The safety, job safety, doesn't come from the company where you work or from profession where you work, but it is primarily coming from you being good at what you are doing. So, and again, you do not bring that safety issue to the interview because people know how often companies might have layoffs, and we all did go through multiple layoffs, which have nothing to do with us, with our performance, just life, you know. And IT field is very dynamic, by the way. The last answer is also good. So it says, it employs my natural talent and passion for perfection. It's a good answer, very good answer. It just has to be yours. You might see people searching answers to typical interview questions on Google, you know, and how to answer this question. Look, it should be your answer. If someone comes with that answer and it helps him, it might not help you because you are a different person. It has to be yours. You have to be sincere. So if you are sincere in enjoying, you know, that IT, high-tech work environment, say it. If you really feel like you have a passion for quality, for perfection, say it. So the more you believe in that, so the better it is, the more these people will trust you. Okay. Then we go to negative testing. Pretty much unanimous, 97%. You are coming with the right answer. You are saying it is aimed at showing that software handles properly situations in which user acts, not as user is supposed to act. So when they develop that software, they mean you use it properly. So let's say you want to create an account, God knows, at Amazon. And it comes with your email, it comes with your name, it comes with your maybe phone number, with your credit card and all that stuff. What if instead of your zip code, you type your last name by mistake? People make mistakes. What if? So that is negative because it is not supposed to be used that way. Yeah. User acts not as user is supposed to act, but people do. Guys, look at yourself. What am I talking about? Look at yourself. People do act not exactly the way they are supposed to act. So they might be distracted. They might be having no idea what they are doing. You know, it's okay. It's normal. So negative testing is about that stuff. Let me show you one thing here. On the school forum, okay, forum.portnow.com, on the school forum, we have that software QA interview questions. Some place where I elaborated for you certain questions Just for the purpose of giving you certain advantage over other people when it comes to an interview. Let me put it in your file. I will talk about what's above here. Let's say okay, correct answer is not good enough. I'm sorry, is not good enough. You ask me, wait a second, but why? Because interview is a competitive activity, so you have to get the job competing with other people, other candidates, and other candidates might be very decent people. So now, how would you beat decent people? You come with correct answer, they come with correct answer. Who gets the job? So correct answer is not good enough. So we have to beat the competition. Beat the competition. So to beat the competition, we are asking ourselves, so how to beat the competition? How to go beyond good? Yeah. And that is why we have that page on the school forum. Look at that, guys. I told you, people are searching for answers. Write test cases for login password functionality. Look at that. 65,000 people came to that page. No, people are looking for answers. Our question was, going back, I'm sorry. Our question was negative testing. Okay, define negative testing. I suppose we might have something for, yeah, define what is negative testing. Yeah. Look at that. We are coming with something more elaborated than the definition we have here. So we have aimed at showing that software handles properly situations in which user acts not as user is supposed to act. And on that questions and answers page, do we have negative testing? Might be, yeah. Positive testing aimed at showing software works as intended when user does correct actions. Negative testing aimed at showing that software handles properly situations in which user acts not as user is supposed to act. And it comes with some details, yeah? Invalid inputs, unreasonable selection of settings, and so on. But here, we are coming with a little bit more elaborated thing. I'm showing you that page as a resource. It's open. I mean, everybody can go and access that. So no matter if you join us or not, you still have access. So it makes no sense aimed at showing that software handles properly situations in which user acts, not as user is supposed to act. Okay, that is the definition. But now we go beyond. That's it. It makes no sense if positive testing fails. For example, if you test login and password functionality and you cannot log in with valid login and valid password combination, you just cannot log in. You don't have to test what happens if you come up with valid login and invalid password. It makes no sense. See what I mean? If positive testing fails, you stop doing it, give it to developers, you know, for further development, and switch your attention to another topic. Negative testing is to be done after positive. Obviously, yeah, you do positive. If positive fails, you don't, you stop doing that, testing that functionality. If positive passes, then you go for negative. In lack of time situation, guys, lack of time is kind of normal situation, I can tell you. You never have enough time for whatever you want to do, you personally or your team as a team. In lack of time situation, minimize negative testing. It's not you who is going to minimize. It's your management who will minimize, who will narrow down the scope of testing because they have no time. And positive testing is more important. Because user who knows what he or she is doing should be able to use that software. Okay? So positive testing has higher priority. Another thing which you should know about negative testing, it results in more bugs than positive. more bugs than positive. Why? Everybody does positive testing. Developers, when they develop the code, they make sure it's working. And honestly, developers are primarily focused on positive testing, not negative. So developers do that, marketing people do that, management do that. Not testing, but they are playing with things, you know, the marketing people, they are preparing presentations, so they go to that software and use it for different purposes. And so lots of people will run into positive testing problems. But negative testing is pretty much neglected. If you don't do it, most likely nobody is going to do it. When we will come to the question of why testers are needed if developers test software anyway, one of the reasons is negative testing. Developers will not do negative testing to the level, to the volume done by testers. Okay. Let me look at you. Are you with me? Okay, good. So far I hope I didn't confuse you with anything. So we are talking about kind of simple things, more obvious. Software testing as a profession, at least at your level, at which you are going to join the market, is much more about common sense rather than specific knowledge of tools and languages, which comes later on when you go to mid-level, senior level. So it will be more about technicalities. But so far, common sense and understanding of basics is what we want. Okay. What is software testing? Aha. What is software testing? So let's, guys, see what you are saying here. So it's an open-ended question. So we have multiple answers. The process of improving the quality of software by comparing the actual behavior of the software with the requirements for the software. Okay, starts at the development stage because deals with code. Not bad. I wouldn't say it is a kind of a technical definition which you find on websites or even on our website, but it is a kind of... In your own words, you know, delivered, it's fine. Process of verification, validation, error detection. If you come with that to an interview, so now you have three questions, at least. Question number one, tell me what's verification, tell me what's validation, tell me what's error detection, and maybe a few more questions, and maybe it is going to be the end of your interview based on the answers you provide. So software testing is verification, validation, okay. The purpose is verification, validation. Yes, we have it here, yeah. Software testing, where is it? Software testing here. Yeah, the purpose of testing is verification, validation, error detection. It's good, it's good. Still, let's say if I would answer that question, yeah? If I would answer that question, let's go to your file. Let's see, software testing. Yeah? Software testing. With all the things which come with that, I would say software testing is making sure that software application is up to the requirements. It is not the full definition, because here we are saying, okay, if we've got requirements, the software should be up to requirements. And that is exactly what is called verification. Yeah? Verification. Software testers do more. Software testers look at the requirements and make sure that requirements are actually benefiting customers. So it is also a part of your job, but primarily, software testing is about verification. And when we are talking about error detection is not something which happens by itself. Error detection is attached to the verification because you run into errors by verifying implementation of requirements. So you are just doing verification and you are running into the problems. And when people look at you from outside, they have an idea that maybe 90% of your time is error detection. It is not true. It's not true. 90% of your time is verification. And error detection is a sub-product of verification. It just naturally, it is happening naturally because you have to report the bugs. And you run into bugs by verifying implementation of requirements. So that is the idea here. But what I want to say, guys, we have many answers here. Software testing is a research software to users' expectations, security back. Where the hell it comes from? Okay. Software testing is about to make sure. Okay, requirements. Okay, look at that. Making sure software application meets requirements by customer. Where the hell that by customer stuff came? I mean, really, what do you mean by customer? Sometimes consulting companies develop software or software development departments of big companies. Let's say in Wells Fargo Bank, you have lots of software development and their customer is the bank itself. So they do it for the bank. Consulting companies develop software for clients, customers. But listen, who is the customer of Google? The search system or Google Maps? Which customer? What are you talking about? One detail like that, okay, might be a big problem because you really do not understand what software testing is about. You bring garbage to something which has to be perfectly clean. You might memorize or study by heart, you know, the definition given to you. You might say it in your own words, which is even better, I would say. But you shouldn't bring any garbage. It should be clean. That is why we give you the answers. So in expectations that you study. Method. Software used to detect difference between software product we have, software product we are required to have. Okay. When I was looking through your answers here, I've noticed lots of things which are far away. Guys, you cannot do it in Russian. I mean, really, we are talking about serious stuff. If you didn't want, you know, to get a job, you don't want to get a job. So you I mean, I don't know. Why would you provide that trash here? Testing and find and fix. The goal of testing is find and fix the errors and problem. It is not really true. Our job is to find those. And fixing them, definitely when we find something, we want it to be fixed, but we do not fix. So other people decide what is worth fixing. So I wouldn't say really fixing. It's not exactly wrong, but it is not what we teach you in that class. And actions to find bugs in software. No, it is not about finding bugs in software. That is another example of something which is not learned in our class. And my point here is, guys, we gave you the answers, okay? We want you to study the answers. So when we tell you you take the quiz, I can repeat, you copy-paste from your mind Meaning your mind is filled with certain knowledge using the resources we give you. Okay. What is software quality? So what do we have here? What is software quality? Okay, we have quality by itself, customer satisfaction, subjective term. What is software quality? Measurement of how close is actual software product to the expected intended product. Yes, and it is customer satisfaction as well. See what I mean? We have two different standpoints when we talk about software quality, because quality is quality. Quality is customer satisfaction to people who use your software. They like it or they don't like it. That's it. If you are in QA department, so definitely to you, quality software is the one which is up to the requirement. But you know what? In the company where you work, there are people who are on consumers' side. You know, let me see. Negative. Okay, let me look at the forum. So it was, what is quality? Software quality. Let's take a look. We are saying from consumer perspective, it is about customer satisfaction. From QA perspective, it's about software being up to requirements. Being up to requirements, 100% up to requirements doesn't make products popular or selling well. People who are new to QA, they think is if a product is tested nicely, you know, people gonna like it. Not really. It's not about software being tested, which is nice. But it is much more about the features of that software. Inside the software company, there are roles who see quality from consumer perspective. Upper management, they don't care really. They don't care about bugs you found, but they do care about sales. You know, people like it, a good review. So upper management, salespeople, public relations, marketing, support. There are people who are on consumer side inside your company. That is giving you some clue to interviewing. If you talk to, let's say, software developers, and you talk about quality, you are talking primarily about software being up to requirements. If you talk to, I don't think you're going to talk to marketing people, which is very rare. The company must be like 5-6 people, so you actually talk to marketing person. But when you talk to management, when you talk to support people, they expect you to be on consumer side, not just being techie who has no idea, who doesn't care about how that software looks to appears to your consumers. Okay, not your consumers, but company client. Okay. What is software quality assurance? By the way, what did you say? I didn't see much. There are two aspects to the question. Good. From consumer point of view, how consumer likes the software or doesn't. From professional point of view, how close or far, how far the application is from the requirement. That is a nice, very nice, I would say perfect answer. Two perspectives. Okay. Good, guys, good. I can tell you right away if you studied things or you just are using your kind of intuition. What is software quality assurance? Normally, that question comes coupled with software testing. So what is the difference between software quality assurance and software testing? To be able to answer the question about the difference, which is a good, very good question. Not many people can answer. So it's good to understand what is software testing. We looked at the software testing. Yeah. So it's about making sure software is up to requirements and requirements are benefiting the customer. So that is software testing. But what is quality assurance? Software quality assurance. Quality assurance is not limited to software. Quality assurance is everywhere, in manufacturing, in pharmaceuticals. It's everywhere. So what is software quality assurance? So you are saying QA is looking at the... What the hell is that? QA is looking at the process of creating software. The point of QA is improving business processes. Yeah, the key word here, guys, is process. If we look at the answers which we give you here, quality assurance, it says, the process of monitoring and improving all activities associated with software development. Software development. It is not just finding bugs in the software, but it is also working with requirements and how those requirements were collected. And do we have any issues with design? Coding and implementation and so on. So software quality assurance is looking at the entire process of software creation from requirements, from the very existence, from the day one. Okay. Software testing needs the code to be tested. You cannot test unless you have the code. Quality assurance, you can start with requirements. So when you see the requirements, you can start looking at the requirements and identify issues in the requirements. If we look at the end of that page, very bottom of that page, it talks about software development lifecycle. And then, let me see. Yeah, I copied that one from Wikipedia at some point. Just to make sure it is not being modified by someone. Look at that. Customers typically know what they want, but not what software should do. While, look at that, incomplete, ambiguous, or contradictory requirements. Guys, you have to remember those three words, because they tell you what might go wrong with requirements, and that is what you as a tester are supposed to expect. It's not like it might be there, it might not be there. Okay. If you are in QA business, you will find requirements which are incomplete. You will find requirements which are ambiguous, means you can interpret that one way or another way. Or contradictory, means one requirement contradicts to another requirement. All three things will be there when you start working. Just remember what I just told you. So, and quality assurance people deal with that. When you test, it's a much later stage. Yeah, the code should be there already. Keep going. What is black or white box testing? So what is the difference? I think we have to have something here on the forum. Let me see. Gray box, okay. Okay, black box. Okay, let's take a look at black box. What does it say? Testing done from user perspective. So no access to the source code used. Guys, pay attention to the word used. Yeah, I might have access. I just don't use it. Because developers also do black box testing. A developer creates the code, okay, and then pretends to be a user, runs that code, pretends to be a user, and make sure it's working. So developer might do the black box testing. He has access to the source code, but he is not using it at that point. So it is not who does that type of testing. It is how it is done. We are testing from user perspective. Now we go beyond the definition. So it's not who does it, as I said, but it's how it is done. Good. Because some people will tell you, black box testing is done by testers and white box testing is done by developers. No, developers might do black box and white box and gray box, all types of testing, including black box. It's not who does it. Bugs in black box testing. Bugs are identified and reported from user perspective. So you are describing that bug as a user who encounters that bug. Then it could be manual. Black box testing could be manual or automated, and it is still black box because it is done through the interface. Because some people say that automated testing, it is something which is not black box. No, it is. I mean, if you use Selenium WebDriver, I mean, popular test automation tools, it is a black box testing. Let me go back to you guys. Any question, by the way? Any question? Okay, let me see what happens in the informal chat, where you guys are not supposed to say anything, okay? Anything. You have to be in the main chat, and you are not supposed to distract other people from the class, okay? So you are in violation of our rules, and you are not doing good to people who probably want to learn something. How you do the quiz more than once? It's a good one. Yes, it leaves some stuff in your yeah, you have to clean the cache, or just use another browser. Yeah, if you want to do it again, just use another browser, another computer. You cannot do it again from same browser without cleaning the cache. Okay, what's here? Nothing. So, guys, so it looks like we are doing fine so far. Black box, white box. So the idea of black box is we test from user perspective. The idea of white box is we are testing from developer's perspective. So we look at the source code and we find and report bugs at the source code level, whatever they use, JavaScript, Java, C sharp, Perl, whatever fancy languages they might use. Yeah, you're pretty good at that. And again, I do not really want you to copy paste anything, as you just did. Imagine you go to an interview, okay, and then you come with something like you cannot come with something like that because you don't have it right here, okay. And you cannot copy paste right there. So from our page, so makes no sense. There is no value in that. Let me talk about something. I call it four levels of learning. Okay. Four levels of learning. It is not my concept. It's a well-known concept in educational theory. So level one. So level one, recognition. So you are saying, oh yeah, I remember we discussed that in the class, but the important thing is student cannot solve the problem without outside help. What about that first level? Let's make it one. Okay, let's make it put number one. Outside help. What is the problem? No job. So it makes no sense to study at that level because there's going to be no job guaranteed. Okay. Number two, reproduction. So student can solve known problems himself. So can solve the problem without outside help. So what do we have here? Hired. That is where you have to be. We have a few more. So that one is called creative. Creativity. Yeah? Creativity means you can do something you didn't do before. Or let's say subjective creativity. Okay. Subjective creativity. You personally didn't do it before. Maybe it's a well-known thing, but you just didn't know. So a student can resolve or solve, can solve an unknown unknown problem. That is something which we will call expert level. Yeah, and then we have something we don't care about at all, that is objective. Objective creativity. That is what scientists are doing. Yeah. So they create knowledge which didn't exist, you know, prior to them. Let's say science, new knowledge, whatever. So guys, you have to be at that level. You have to be at that level. What is the what's in between, guys? How to move from first level to the second level? Tell me, guys. You should be able to answer that question. What is in between number one and number two? Practice. Okay, good. Yeah, practice. Good, I like it. Maybe you knew the answer, but guys, practice and let's say hard work. So that is why we give you the homework. So to move from no job to the hired, so you have to spend some time learning. We are not here to learn the definitions, guys. Don't get me wrong. We are looking at definitions. We are supposed to be able to come up with explanation of what is this and what is that. We have to understand the terminology. We have to understand the subject matter, and it comes maybe with a little bit of memorizing stuff at first, but it's a part of the deal. We are not learning definitions. We are learning software testing, which requires knowledge of some definitions. So then we go to, okay, define software development lifecycle. Here, guys, we have to recognize two different models of software development life cycle. So one model, traditional one, is called waterfall, and we touch it a little bit, but primarily in our class we will focus on another model, which is called agile. And agile is everywhere, and waterfall still exists, but we do not want to emphasize that. In our first session, I do mention the software development lifecycle in the waterfall kind of model, because I want you to have some idea of what it is. And I was on that page, look at that, it's what is software development lifecycle. So, and that one is, the way we talk about it is waterfall. And we are saying, okay, software development lifecycle is, let's go here. Software development lifecycle is a conceptual model used in project management that describes the stages involved in an information system development project, from an initial feasibility study through maintenance of the completed application. If it is in agile development model, it is still the conceptual model used in project management, just different approach. So who needs software development lifecycle? Management people. They go from stage to stage, and at each and every stage they have certain things they can manage. They have deliverables, they have schedule, you know, timelines, they have resources, so they can really manage. And when we talk about software development lifecycle in waterfall, so what was the question here? It was saying, define. Okay, it is not talking about stages of software development lifecycle, but what I want to tell you, there is a very common mistake which people make. When they are asked to define the cycle, instead, they come with defining the stages. And let me go to Google. Yeah, SDLC. So you just understand and I say images. Okay, SDLC. Look how many pictures are here, and they are different. They are not exactly the same. For example, that one has 6 stages, and that one has 5, and that one has 6, another 6. 6. It might be many more than 6. Look at that one, for example. Look at that one. It has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It depends on what kind of company, what kind of software. So there are multiple configurations of that. That one has what? That one has 7. Let me go to the top of that list. Let's say, okay, let's take 5 stages. What does it say? It says requirements analysis. Yeah, someone should come with requirements. Normally, business analysts are doing that part of the job. So they are going to the field in waterfall model. So in Agile, it's different. So they go to the field, they study, then it comes to... I would put one more stage between requirements and design. So design is basically the architecture. So how that software will be built in terms of different modules, units of that software, and how units communicate to each other. Implementation. Implementation here means coding, programming. Testing, evolution. I would say that is something really rare. I wouldn't use that. Let's go to that one. It says, number one, planning, analysis. Analysis, at the end of analysis, they have requirements. Design, implementation, which means programming, testing and integration, maintenance. Maintenance is where you go from 1.0 to 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, 2.0, 2.1, 2.3. Software needs some maintenance, fixing bugs, making little modifications and so, or substantial modifications when it comes from 1 point something to 2.0, for example. Okay, that is pretty much what it says in our materials, the one I gave you to look at. It says software elements analysis, requirements, software architecture, implementation or coding, testing, documentation, training and support. Training and support is something for specific type of organizations, not everywhere. And maintenance, so it explains what's maintenance. So guys, my suggestion to you is use it. There is another page here, which is a nice page with a certain explanation of how it works. We do not want to spend too much time on that. I can promise you. But when you come to the question, what is software development lifecycle? You're saying it is a conceptual model used in project management, which describes the software development process in stages. And you stop right there. You do not come with stages. Let them ask you, What stages, for example? Or you can say, describes software development process in stages. And then you say, for example, let me see if we have anything here in your... What is software development lifecycle? Conceptual model used in project management, which describes software development process in stages. And it says waterfall. Guys, be careful. Waterfall. And... I will give you some examples of stages, okay? Oh, actually, it's here. Yeah, I will not. It's already here. What are the common stages? Yeah, it says analysis. So business analysts will do that, and they create use cases. And use cases is the format. Use case is the format for creating the requirements. And use case is a kind of communication between user and the system, kind of multi-step kind of sequence of things. Technical requirements, design or architecture, And scalability is a very important characteristic of architecture. So scalability means it could be extended or modified, you know, nicely without doing too much work. Development, sometimes it's called coding, sometimes it's called implementation. I don't like the word implementation because implementation is also used when you have to train people, when you have to install and set up, configure, and blah, blah, blah in your organization. Testing, documentation, maintenance. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, 7. So you might offer the stages, but you do not use it in definition of software development lifecycle. The definition is very, very simple. It's conceptual model used in project management, which describes software development process in stages. You can say, for example, yeah, it's okay, but you have to understand that different organizations have different vision of stages. So that is why it's very dangerous to make stages a part of your definition. Okay? Keep going. What is use case? Yeah, as I said before. So use case, and we have it here. Yeah, use case. Yeah. Use case is a format used by business analysts to specify system requirements. You can stop right here. It is just important to understand what it looks like, what does it do. So each use case normally represents completed business operation performed by user. From the QA perspective, we will execute corresponding end-to-end tests. Okay, we will talk about types of testing later on. But if I take the use case and I give it to QA person, and QA person will just execute that use case, so it is covered under end-to-end test. End-to-end test is not limited to execution of use cases, but still, use case. And again, use cases belong to the waterfall model. In Agile, you will deal with user stories, slightly different type of document. And again, I don't want to go into Agile. You're going to get tons of Agile in that class. Okay, keep going. What is the difference between software testing and software quality assurance? You remember? We discussed that already. So software testing begins with the code. Quality assurance begins with the day one. Software testing is looking at the code. The object of software testing is the code. The object of software quality assurance is the process of creating the code. Yeah? Software testing is comparing actual result to requirement, and software quality assurance is the process of creating. Well, I would say it's very humble kind of answer. Software testing is a process of checking. Guys, never use the word checking. Okay, yeah, it's a prohibited word. We are not checking anything. We are verifying. We are validating. We are making sure. We are not checking anything. The source code against requirements. It is not. It is not. We are not verifying source code. If you are doing black box testing, you are not verifying source code. Okay. The difference is, and the question is, what is the difference? The question is not what is this and what is that. The question is, what is the difference? Yeah? And I gave you two differences. I said software testing is looking at code. Software quality assurance is looking at the process of creating that code. And software testing begins with the code, and quality assurance begins from the day one of the project. Yeah, starts with requirement. So the question is really about differences, not tell me what's this and what's that. Testing is mainly focused on source code. Guys, you are not coming with good answers here. Okay, keep going. What is regression testing? Okay. Let's see what we teach you here. Negative, positive, God, where is regression? Black box. It is not on that page? Okay, let's see. So what are you saying? Regression testing is made when code has been changed. Okay. We have something here, I believe. Regression. Do we have regression here? No? Maybe second page. Functionality. Regression. Okay, let's take a look. Elaborated definition. So partial retesting of a modified program to make sure that no new errors were introduced while making changes to the code. Guys, developers change the code every day. Their job is to change the code. They develop new features or they fix existing bugs, but they modify the code each and every day. Anytime they modify the code, they might break something down. The word partial here is not the actual definition, but partial is the reflection of the real life. In the real life, you cannot test completely the whole thing, you know, every time the code was changed. So we have to define which part to change. That is why it's partial. It should be done for each new release. Or build, okay, let's say build, is a compiled version of the code. It might incorporate changes made within a couple of days, or sometimes even longer, or maybe just one day. But it is not about just one minor change. Again, it might be like that, but normally it's about more changes. So, and then the build is done, and it goes to testers. In between build done and build going to testers, there is another type of testing where they decide that build is good enough to go to QA. We will talk about different types of testing, and there is a test called build acceptance. So if it is not accepted, so it is not going to QA. So then it goes to QA. And what QA does, makes sure that nothing got broken. Nothing got broken. That is, whatever used to work is not broken. So it says, we do not have enough time to retest software completely. Risk analysis is involved. Yeah, so we have to decide which part to retest. Second, to release acceptance or build acceptance, most frequently executed test. So each and every compiled version will go for acceptance, build acceptance or release acceptance. But some of them will not pass. They're going to fail. So the number of builds coming to QA for regression is less than the number of builds created and tested. So that is why it is second to release acceptance or build acceptance, most frequently executed test. And it is a very good candidate for automation because whatever is frequently executed, guys, is a good candidate for automation. So regression and build acceptance are good candidates for automation. Now, common mistakes. It says avoid. Avoid saying that it is done after fixing a bug. It is broader than that. It's about any changes made to the code. Avoid saying it is about feature being added. It is broader than that. It's both fixing and features and whatever modifications might be done. Making sure the bug was fixed. Making sure the bug is fixed is not a regression testing. In older books, guys, many years ago, they would say regression testing is either making sure nothing got broken or making sure the bug was fixed. For the last 25 years, guys, I do not see anybody who will say that. I mean, in their practical work. So don't do that. Not about manual, automated, or black or white. Means regression testing could be done manually or in automated way, both. I mean, whichever way you do it. Many companies are willing to automate, but you know what? It could be done manually as well. And it is not black or white box. It could be done through the interface. It could be done from the source code side. Really, it is not about how it is done. It's about why it is done. It is done to make sure that nothing got broken. Whichever methods, techniques, tools you might be using. Okay, so what do we have? Executed after code change. It's not true. It is executed after build was created. Build. See what I mean? Should be done to make sure that nothing was broken after the code change. Not really. Not really. I mean, executed after. You know, God. Some garbage is coming here. Okay. Nothing is broken and no new bugs appear when they were not present before. Okay, yeah, good, good. To me, is broken and no new bugs appear is the same. Honestly. But yes, it's okay. Regression testing is whenever you rerun in functional or non-functional tests to see if it is going to be any changes. Honestly, I'm not sure. I have to think about it. I'm not sure about non-functional. Not sure about non-functional. I mean, in the real practice of software companies, it is focusing on functional testing. So non-functional, maybe. I won't really emphasize that. I won't. Regression testing is testing performed after code modification to be sure newly created code is not broken. Okay. You can say code, you can say build, you can say whatever, but just remember, you have to understand that code is one thing and build is another thing. Yeah? Build, when all the changes are incorporated, you know, into one build, and that build, if it passes build acceptance, will go for regression. Okay? It's not one change, you know, will go for regression. Okay? So the entire build goes for regression. So we are pretty much done here. Let me go, guys, through the notes. Okay, so you know that is your website. It's not portnov.com, which is a campus website. So online website is portnov.net. Campus website is portnov.com. That is the page where we do our first three sessions. Forum, when you register for the forum, and that is your session two assignment, it will ask for why you are here, what's the reason. So that is the answer. Any other answer is not going to work. Okay. You will report bugs at that forum for a while. So after session number three, you will go to, I mean, you pay the money, you go to the smaller group, and in that smaller group, starting with session four, you will use Jira for bug reporting. And maybe Jira with X-Ray, which is an add-on. You will see. So I'm not teaching that part, so the other people manage that. So that is how you register at the forum. Here is, if you want to pay, no, it's not about payments. What the hell is it? Forum, software QA testing interview questions. Yeah, that is that part of the forum where we keep interview questions. Course payment link. So lots of you are asking if I can pay now. Guys, no rush. You have three sessions. We want you to really know what you are doing. I understand that some of you came predetermined, you know, to join the class. It's your choice. I'm just saying, no rush exists. If you want to pay, okay, that is where you go. And you can go to, let me show you, by the way. Let me show you, because there is some confusion there. You go to that page. And the confusion is in PayPal or credit card. You go to PayPal checkout. PayPal doesn't mean you have to be with PayPal. PayPal is an agency which is servicing that stuff. And it will... Pay with PayPal. No, we don't want to pay with PayPal. Wait a second. Login. No. Okay. Whatever your PayPal account, you can pay with PayPal here. But if you do not want to pay with PayPal, you want to pay with credit card, you go here. Pay with debit or credit card here. Debit or credit card. And then you come here and you just, you have Discover, Visa, MasterCard, American Express. That is how you pay. And at the end of the payment, it will ask you to register. But you can also register this way. Register. Without registration, guys, yeah, I cannot give you access to the resources. So that is how it works. So let me give you that one to copy. Register. So if you do the payment, it will bring you there. Registration. Okay. Okay, registration is here. Correct answer is not good enough. Okay, we talked about that stuff. Zip code field requirements. Okay, we will not have it now. Four levels of learning. Yes, what is software testing? We discussed. Software development life cycle. Yes. Common stages of software development, waterfall software development lifecycle, software quality assurance, looks at the process and begins from the day one, software testing, making sure nothing, regression testing, I'm sorry, making sure nothing was broken as a result of code being modified. As a result of code being modified, when you get a new build coming for regression testing. That is the page. One of the things we have in that class, when you graduate, we have kind of in-house test, which may, to make sure you are ready to go to the market. And Laura is helping me with clearances. And we have 12 questions here. So those 12 questions are to prepare. And it talks, I mean, look, we already answered one question here, yeah? Regression testing, we did that. We mentioned build acceptance, didn't talk much in depth. What brought you to Key Field? Tell me about yourself, blah, blah, blah. So 12 questions. Definitely when it comes to the clearance itself, so you will be asked more questions, this and that, but that is pretty much where the focus is. When you go to an interview, you have to be able to talk about the software you tested. We will have two projects in the class. And you might also go for a bootcamp with Sophia or Galina, which is another project. It's 1 month, 1 month project. So you have projects, you have what that application is doing, what is the typical day at work, what is the company which created that application, why you are in QA, tell me about yourself, so all the questions we will answer in that class, guys. No worry about that part. And many more questions will be answered in that class. But I just wanted you to have that link so you have an idea of what's ahead. And now, guys, any questions? Because I'm pretty much done with my agenda. How big will be our groups? I have no idea. So as of now, I can see 252 people in this Skype, in that chat. My estimation is that it might be maybe 150 people. That is why we have bootcamps, because in bootcamps we have 20 people, you know, and for a month you have tons of individual attention. That is why we have campus, and on campus groups, it's very difficult to imagine more than 30 people, let's say 25 people, and so, but it's more expensive. I mean, it costs 5,000, not one, but it gives you more attention. Imagine that I have a class of 150 people and they're paying $1,000, and then I split them into smaller groups, like 25 in a group. So it's six. I have to charge 6,000 to do it with 25 to get same amount of money. So okay, tomorrow we have automation class, right? No, you do not have automation class. That is why. Okay, it's a good point. So guys, let's take a look. What's next? Session number two of your class will happen on Thursday, 20th of May. And again, you start with your homework. You watch the video. You look at that website. We talk about it in the video. You apply that GUI checklist to that form, which is kind of practice a little bit. Repeat interview questions and answers. Repeat, and now you do it the right way. So it goes exactly to your mind, not you know, anywhere else. You take the survey, second survey, which is built out of same questions, but slightly different. So you do that survey. So we are practicing and doing the survey right. You watch a little video. You register with U-Test. And we have a video on how to practice with U-Test. You register at the school forum, and I gave you the password. And then we have that GUI testing assignment. It is coming from a company which was purchased by Oracle at some point, called Tolia, many years ago. And that page was, they used to give that page to students, to people who come for a job interview. And they still keep asking that same thing. 10 years after, you know, they still give them that page and ask, what's wrong here? And that is what session two is about. Yeah. So you practice. And that is pretty much what it is. And you watch the February 4th video where we go through all that stuff. And again, we are learning. And maybe for the first three sessions, the major kind of difficulty is to adjust to new subject matter, to kind of new world of different things. When you get used to that, so you will be able to focus more on certain details, concepts, and so on. So I'm trying to make it simple. And I'm not doing 2 hours, you know, sessions. I'm doing just 1 hour session. Actually, it's hour and a half. It's fine. So to make sure you're not overwhelmed with the information. When it comes to automation, when it comes to schedule, so we have, let me go to the website, portnov.net website, and I go to FAQ, and it's when it talks about schedule, it says we have certain things on, yeah, schedule. We have three live sessions from either 6 to 7 or 6 to 8 p.m. California. And we have also automation. Yeah, automation is on Wednesdays. But you have to get to that point. We will start automation maybe in the middle of the class. So we do not want automation to interfere with basics of software testing. So it will start later than sooner, and it is not a part of the first three sessions, introductory, blah blah blah. It's a completely different thing. Let me see more questions. Good questions. I like them. Okay. More about the difference in the programs of this class comparing to the old online classes. It used to be 40 hours. For 9 years in a row, the class was about 40 hours. And then when pandemic came, we added 20 more hours on test automation. So it became 60. But now we are adding more with back-end testing. So it is going to be back-end testing with SQL, back-end testing with Unix. And I did show you that page on the FAQ. So it talks about each and every piece of it. So that is how it works. We will do more in terms of interview preparation. I have I took 5 more hours on interview preparation. We have 5 more hours on the mobile testing and project. So there are a couple of things we wanted really to add to that. So kind of we moved from 60 to 100 hours. Can you become a QA engineer without higher education? Yeah, it is possible. No, I mean, it is doable. Say you can become a software developer without higher education. Yeah. When I can pay for the course? You cannot go to session 4 without paying for the course. So session 1, 2, 3, you're okay. If you want to go to session 4, you pay for the course. How is it going to be if I'm going to learn automation too? What's the problem? I do not understand. How is it going to be if I'm going to learn? I'm not sure, up to which level you want to learn the automation. We have on the Portnov campus, we have a very strong test automation class. And you can take it with a great discount. So it's, instead of $2,350, you will pay $1,600. So they give you $850, discount if you want to really go in depth. But in our program, automation comes pretty much as an introductory thing, which helps you to get a job in manual testing rather than in automation. Where and when we can see the record of the session, guys, that is where it is. It is going to be right here. Today, you see that February 2nd here, and within a couple of hours, instead of February 2nd, it will be May 18th. And February 2nd will be here. That is how it works. So I will put it on that page. On that page. Okay, what else? Little bit confused, returning to question from the quiz. This is what is written and that source which you provided us. What is the difference between software testing and software QA? Testing is mainly focused on the source code. Yes. Quality assurance measures the quality of processes used to create, yeah. So process for quality assurance and source code for testing, yeah. So that thing helps you to see two perspectives. So one perspective is code versus process, and another perspective, starting from the day one or starting from the day we have code to be tested. So in the in my token, so I gave you a little bit broader kind of view on that stuff. So I do not see any conflicts here really. Is it included in basic online course, or should I pay differently and join another group for automation? We have 20 hours of automation in that class. 20 hours of automation. If you want real strong professional grade course, which allows you to get a job in automation, it's a different course, which comes with substantial discount and it costs $1,600 if you want to go for it. We have 20 hours included in 1,000 tuition. Is manual testing still in demand? Oh, yes. A lot of vacancies include requirements automation of different kinds. That is the matter of money. Let's say manual versus automation. Yeah? Manual testing Manual testing money wise comes to, let's say, 30 to maybe 40 dollars per hour. Yeah? I mean, some people will tell you 50. It is not kind of the what the market is about. It might be, yeah. We have people getting over 50 sometimes, but it is not what the market is. So you will be looking anywhere in between 30 to 40. I would say maybe closer to 30 to be on the safe side. I do not want to promise you something which might not happen. So let's say that is where you are in manual testing. In automation, if we talk about our dollars per hour, it starts with 50. It starts with 50, 50 plus. So basically, if they hire people at 30 bucks, 35, 40 bucks per hour, nobody expects any automation. They might still ask questions. That is why we included 20 hours of automation to help you to get get a manual testing job. Yeah, because when they interview for manual testing jobs, they want to make sure you understand the basics of automation. It happens a lot. So that is why we do that. Okay, file, save, good. Keep going. For the quiz, can we study the answers from Portnoy sessions and try the same in quiz, or do we need to reproduce in our own language? I would say until you really become fluent in that stuff, you know? It's good to come up with a definition. At some point, it will be more natural to you to say it in your own words. I remember definitions, but if you ask me, Michael, what is this? I will tell you in my own words what it is, because it has more value. If I come to an interview and I say it in my own words, it's much better than coming with some stuff which was memorized, you know? And people sense that. Can we work for USA companies remotely from Canada? People work remotely from different countries. It is not exactly what our school is about. I mean, we do not have much of exposure to that kind of training. Some people ask same question, can I do that from Ukraine? Can I do that from Tajikistan? You know? Yes, some people find jobs remotely. From my perspective, the higher the skill level, so the easier it is to find a job remotely. I have DevOps skills. How can I transfer it in my resume and LinkedIn account? Any chance to get a job with 0 years QA experience with DevOps skills? There is always a chance, which is not zero, okay? It is close to zero, but it's not zero. So there is always a chance. The major issue in your situation is you have to get in front of someone who is hiring. That is how I got my first job. So a friend of mine brought me to the company where he worked, and then they talked to me and they hired me. And I had nothing, I mean, really, and my education is not in software. My education is in electronics and in mathematics, and then in pedagogics. So I did postgraduate study, you know, in education. But look, and they hired me because of electronics and mathematics and whatever, just they liked me, that's it. So if you can get, you know, in front of people who are hiring, yeah, why not? Another question is, if you have DevOps skills, why don't you go and get DevOps jobs? I mean, DevOps jobs are in a high demand. I mean, people are in a high demand. Why would you go for QA? How long are automation classes? We have 20 hours, 10 sessions, 10 Wednesdays. The bootcamp is 80 hours. You can go to the campus. You can go to the campus website and look at it. So portnoy.com. So you go to you look at the campus schedule. Not really schedule. Wait a second. Let's say Silver Bootcamp is Java, for example. That is what Slava is doing, and he's a legendary guy. And that is what they do. And it is 80 hours, should be somewhere here. Yeah, it has 80 hours, and they expect you to spend another 120, you know, practicing. And that is the cost to strangers. But if you are coming from the online class, that is what you pay if you go through the online class. So different categories of people might pay different amounts of money. They do not outline it here, but I can tell you. Okay. Normally, that 80 hours is delivered in 20 sessions. Each session is 4 hours, twice a week. That is how they normally do. Back to manual. What is the usual salary for QA testing if it is not an hourly wage in San Diego? You start, I would say it is extremely unusual to be paid less than 60, 65, 70 K. Let's say 60 to 70, it normally doesn't go below that. It might, hypothetically it might, but overall I would say it's very rare. In-depth course on campus, yeah, it is, what's it, how long, yeah. 10 weeks, yeah, two sessions, so 8 hours a week. So we are looking at 10 weeks. Back to manual versus automation work. Very often the salary is not published. Yeah, sure. How you would understand what level of automation to expect from the employer? There is a market. It is not what that specific employer wants or another specific employer wants. It's about reaching a certain level at which there's going to be an employer which hires you. And people who teach you, people who create the curriculum, they know what's in demand. So that is how it works. In your case, you just have to trust them. In some SQL, is some SQL question could be on interview? They might. Yeah, if you have SQL in your resume, you claim some SQL, they definitely might ask questions. And we go through interview questions on SQL and we practice SQL. Is it possible to get a job visa as a QA in US company from Ukraine? I would say realistically, you would start work in Ukraine, go to a company such as EPAM or maybe Luxoft, companies which send people to US and other different countries using L1 visa. So they send you kind of corporate transfer, you know, within the corporation. So that is the easiest way. I don't want you to go through H-1B visa process, at least nowadays, because it is not going to work. I don't think there is any chance. But as a corporate transfer, yes, it works. What is the best time to book the place for automation class online? Closer to the date, maybe 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks. So there is no rush. Where I can get your notepad whose name is session Y, blah, blah, blah. Guys, as soon as we finish the session and I know that I'm done, so I can tell you, okay, guys, I'm done. Okay, I am done. So then I will go to my desktop, boom, 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 desktop, 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 online class. Session one, so I put it in your class, so you've got your file, and it goes normally to the extra. Okay, so you've got your files, yeah, you can see it. Tell more details about the bootcamp schedule. Guys, it is, I mean, you can do it. You go to bootcamps, okay. Bootcamp schedule, No, wait a second. There is a schedule for the entire school. Let's take a look. You have schedule for the school. You have... Okay, that is automation bootcamp with Java. So October 25th. Test automation with Python. June 24th. Then if you go to internships, bootcamps, internships, they have their own schedule right here. Schedule. And then, come on, schedule. No. No. Should be working, I don't know. Used to be working, I can tell you. Internship companies, okay, schedule. Yes, okay, it is working. No, wait a second. Not really. They used to have their own schedule. Practicum mobile. I will ask them to fix that. They used to have schedule for boot camps only. Okay, that is why it doesn't go anywhere, because we are already on that schedule. Uh-huh. Okay. Mobile test automation, flex coding. Yeah, they do not really have those boot camps here. Internship requirements, boot camp. Yeah. Daily evening, daily boot camp. Interesting. Do they have schedule? Okay, guys, there is something to be fixed on the page. It was working. Just a few days ago it was working. I will tell them. We start boot camps every month. So we have two people who are doing boot camps, and boot camps takes either 5 weeks in the daytime and 6 weeks if it is happening on evenings. Okay, guys, I think we have to finish for today. You have missed. Would you please scroll up? Okay, what is the question? I don't know what exactly I missed. I can look for your icon there. But okay, what we have to do for the next class? I told that. Was it? No, it was different one. It's Maya. I do not see Maya here, really. Maya, I don't know. Either you ask me that question again, or I don't know what to say. Okay. No, I don't think it needs a regression test. I think it was done intentionally. For a reason, I don't know. Is it correct that we have 4 months of this course and then 2 months for internship? Internship is not going to be 2 months. It is going to be just 5 weeks. After all this, we can work. Is it correct? Yeah, it is correct. Not 2 months. I mean, if you take two internships, so you can go for two if you want to, but... and it's not 4 months, it's 3.5, basically. So we start on 18th, and the next class starts on September 6th. So it's not exactly 4 months, it's close to four, but not exactly four. So more like 3.5 months. Schedule of internship is below. Maybe, I don't know. Guys, scroll down. Okay, scroll down. I don't know where schedule of internships is. Maybe you mean here. I don't know, guys. You can exchange the data, or you can write to me directly in Skype. I just do not want to take attention of so many people while we are looking at minor things. So. Remind all of us what days of the week will you be holding these online classes. We have Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday. Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday. And at some point in the middle of the class, we will add test automation on Wednesdays. So that is, and all that information is on the FAQ page. Okay, guys, thank you very much. And I would say that that video will be available to the public, and I will also put it on our Silicon Valley Voice channel, where more people might be interested in seeing it. And I would appreciate if you also kind of no spamming, but if you share the link to that video after it comes to life, so maybe more people might be interested. And enrollment is not limited to the first three sessions. So some people come in a week, in 2 weeks, in 3 weeks. So it also works out. So we can accommodate those. So guys, thank you very much. And it was my pleasure to entertain you today. And I'll see you Thursday this week. And please, 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 please do the homework. Okay? Thank you very much.